evening. Chag Sameach, everyone. Baruch Hashem, we have a few days to relax. I know that not everyone has off for Chol HaMoed. I speak to people, they ask me questions. From the question, I understand that their work is usual. Many Jews do not know that in the days of Chol HaMoed, it's 100% a holiday. Even though we're allowed to drive or to do certain things that normally we don't do on a holiday, but it's still a holiday. A person should do anything he can not to work on Chol HaMoed. Even to lose the money, if they cannot take off, you know, for like paid vacation, they rather lose the pay and take off from the Yom Tov. The only people that should work, allowed to work, are people that are very poor, that they need the money that they make for food. Meaning if they don't work, they won't have what to eat. That's, people like this are allowed to work. But people that have some savings, they can survive a week without working, they must take off. When I say must, I can tell you the word of Chazal. Chazal, 2,000 years ago, they said that המבזה את המועדות אין לו חלק לעולם הבא. Someone who disrespect the holidays have no share to the world to come. They ask, what does it mean to disrespect the holiday? I mean, who disrespect the holiday? Usually people love the holidays, no? Even secular people love holidays. They don't celebrate it correctly, but they still love the holidays. So what does it mean to disrespect the holiday? The answer is to work on Chol HaMoed. That's what it means, to work on Chol HaMoed. It's a little bit scary. I mean, usually there is a list of very, very serious sins that a person, God forbid, can lose his share to the world to come. It's no joke. A person can lose his eternity for committing certain sins. But who would ever dream that working in Chol HaMoed is one of them? Right? I mean, to be Mechalel Shabbat, to murder, to eat on Yom Kippur, to eat chametz on Pesach, to go with a married woman, to be gay, all these things are extremely severe. It's horrible sins. But to work on Chol HaMoed, you put it in the same category, it's a little bit scary. Most people are not aware of it. They could easily take off. I just don't want to give out the money. The truth is that you should remember the rule, which I repeated probably hundreds of times by now. It's simple common sense, even though it's written clearly. There's no question about it because it's written. But even if it was not written, every normal, clever person should have known it without the Torah. There is no way ever to benefit from doing something that Hashem doesn't like. There's no such thing. Temporarily, the illusion is that you look like you're gaining something. If you work on Shabbat, you just got paid a few hundred dollars for the job. It looks like you just gained something. But in the long run, you must lose this money, guarantee. Two flat tires, engine pop, you know, burning, all kinds of unexpected things. The calculation in Shamayim is how much money you made in an illegal way. And this money must leave your pocket. And that's not the punishment. Make no mistake. Losing what you stole, losing money that you made on Shabbat or on holidays, losing it, and just because it got into your hand in an illegal way. But that's really not the punishment. The punishment for disrespecting all of that, the punishment is something different. That's besides the point, right? So we should know that since we gain nothing, we only have what to lose, why not to have a day off to enjoy with the family? The Gemara says, the holidays are meant half for Hashem, half for yourself. Half for yourself, meaning you can go to the park, I don't know if you can go swimming, of course in a kosher way, trips, half of the time, half for yourself, and half for Hashem, meaning you still need to learn Torah. So the yeshivot, they have off, the serious bachurim, they sit and learn half a day, and then they go to places. But they still learn. Why? There is no such thing to go one day without learning Torah. Just like there is no such thing to go one day without eating. You need to eat. You need to drink. You also must learn Torah. Minimum 2 hours a day. And every 24 hours. The minimum of the minimum is 1 hour in the morning, 1 hour at night. Otherwise, how can you pray Arvit? Are you allowed to lie in the middle of praying? Imagine you stand in front of Hashem and you begin with your lies. Hashem, you know how holy I am. You know I haven't committed a sin for years. Just 5 minutes ago, he committed the worst sin. Standing in front of God and lying. Is that a good idea? That's a terrible idea. It only makes things worse, right? You stand in front of a judge in a secular court, you lie to him. Sometimes it helps you to get away with something. As a human being, what does he know? Either he believes you or doesn't, but he cannot lie in front of the real judge, which is Hashem. So he knows who you are. He cannot come and stand and make up lies. So the idea is, when you come to pray Arvit, what do we say in Arvit? Kiem Chayenu. We talked about the Torah. The Torah is our life, ve'orech yamenu, and the length of our life, meaning it gives us extra life, long life. Uvahem ne'ege yomam v'layla. And we would learn the Torah day and night. Why? Because we cannot live a minute without it. That's what we say in Arvit. Imagine you stand in front of Hashem, it's a beautiful speech. When is the last time you open a book? Can't remember exactly when. So how do you pray Arvit? Saying something that it's completely off? You're not, the Torah is not the main thing in your life. You don't learn day and night. You learn once in a while. Good news is that some people ask me, Rabbi, I'm not such a good learner with books, but I listen to your lectures every day. Is that considered learning? The answer, yes. It's learning. You learn Torah, you learn Musar, you learn sometimes Halachot. You learn about the parasha, it's also Torah. Especially if it makes you a better human being. You know, I got yesterday a message from a Goy, non-Jew. He was already listening to me for years. He lives in Chile. He sends me from time to time messages. If I wouldn't know he's a Goy from Chile, Chile is not exactly a place with lots of Jews and lots of Torah, you know. So it's some kind of isolated in a world of Goyim there. If you read his messages, you would be convinced that he's 10 years in yeshiva. You wouldn't believe that he's a non-Jew. Forget about it. You take every secular Jew, he doesn't know what this guy knows. The way he talks, the way he thinks, the way he hates the bed, how he suffers among the goyim around him. Very, very surprising that you have non-Jews like this, that love the Torah so much and change completely. So the last message he sent me is updating me about his progress. Probably listening to us as we speak. So his last update is that for a while he hasn't said a lie. He's now watching very carefully not to say any lie from his mouth. If I wouldn't be embarrassed, I would ask you, someone who didn't say a lie for the last week, please raise his hand. But since I don't want to embarrass myself or anyone else here, I will skip the question, but you got the point. So a person that is not Jewish, did not grow up Jewish, did not grow up with Torah, the only Torah he listens to is basically mine, already reached a level he cannot stand the lies, the lack of modesty, the goyish world that he lives in. Basically, if he'd live in New York, he probably would be a convert already years ago in yeshiva full time. This is, by the way, something that will be held against us, the Jews from birth. Goyim like this guy will get us into a lot of trouble. You may ask, why? What's the connection? The answer is, הגמרא עשה קשים גרים לישראל כספחת. The converts, הגמרא talks about the real one, those who become serious religious Jews, they are like a disease in the skin of the nation of Israel. It's metaphoric. Imagine the nation of Israel is one body combined with millions of souls. And in the body of that soul, of that nation, there is some kind of a disease, a rash, leprosy, whatever you want to call it. Sapachat. Sapachat is that when the skin becomes white, you have to take it to the Kohen, he has to tell you if it's kosher or not. And right away the question is asked, why? It's good that we have more and more righteous people joining us. The more religious people we have, the better it is, no? Yeah, of course. There's only one problem. When these people leave their fake world and they become so serious and so religious and so what they call today fanatic, the way they learn, the way they pray, the way they change their dress, everything about them is completely different, and they makpid in every little detail. And some of them don't even have money, but they're willing to pay hundreds of dollars for arbat aminim, when you know that that's basically the last penny they have. That brings a lot of us, especially, you know, those who are not so great, the Satan is making a party out of it. He comes to Hashem and says, look at this Jew, look at his father, look at his grandfather, look at what generations he comes from very holy people. Look at his grandfather in Bukhara, in Afghanistan, in Iran, in Ashkenaz, in Syria. Look what family he comes from and look how he behaves. And look at this guy. His grandfather was some kind of a Nazi in Germany or in Poland or in Ukraine. Look from what garbage he came from and look from what holy place this guy came from. And who's better? This guy is a million times better. He's a girl now. He's a convert. He's already much better than this guy. Right away, the Satan is using it against those Jews that are Jewish from birth. That's why, although it's very good to add converts to the Jewish nation, but you know, every good comes with a bad. Every bad comes with a good. There's always good and bad in everything. In this world, there is no such thing, only good. Every good has some bad in it. Only in the next world, when Hashem say, I pay reward for the righteous, it's pure good, without anything bad in it. You may ask, what could be, there are certain things in life that are pure good. There's nothing bad in them. The answer is no such thing. The fact that everything in this world, every pleasure you have, whether it's physical, whether it's spiritual, it's always temporary. It ends at some point. It ends. And in the next world, there's no such thing, it ends. There's no time out. The pleasure is eternal, as a constant, it never goes down, it's to the highest maximum level for billions and trillions of years. It will never end. Meaning the soul will remain in the highest level of spiritual pleasure, and it's no such thing, oh, let's take a time out, let's have a day off. There's no such thing, only here. You enjoy an hour, it stops. You enjoy 5 hours, it stops. You enjoy 10 minutes, it stops. There's always a stop here. And even while the pleasure is going, there is always something to make it not 100% perfect, as always. But in the next world, since it's 100% divine, pure, nothing is material over there, there is no limitation, no end to anything, it's unbelievable. So therefore, Rabotai, the Gemara say, why Hashem spread the Jews in all the nations? The Torah told us the answer. Why the Gemara asks such a question? The Torah says, if you misbehave, the Holy Land will vomit you. Meaning, it's like throwing something out of the system, right? Vomiting it out. So the land will vomit you and you'll be scattered among the nations. That's the official reason why Jews live all over the world. It's a punishment. Even though they love America very much, They love Forest East, they love Great Neck, they love Jamaica Mistake, they love all these places. But in reality, they love it because of, excuse my language, because of pure stupidity. If they would only really taste the pleasure of learning Torah, for instance, they would do it constantly for a few weeks. They will be in such a high feeling of learning Torah, everything that they love until now when it comes to materialistic things would look like a joke in their eyes. It'll be a total joke. The only reason why people are attracted to so many physical things in this world, it's only because they are empty from inside. Emptiness. It's similar to taking drugs. People that are empty and miserable and lonely and sad and depressed normally are running into drugs and alcohol. What is the trick? Why they run into drugs? Why half of the world smoke grass or more? Why? For what? To run away from the stress, to run away from the reality. Why they have stress? Because they don't have faith. They don't have Hashem in their life. If they would be attached to Hashem, they wouldn't have stress. They would know everything happens to me is the best thing that happened to me. I have to thank Hashem for every minute, whether I make money, whether I lose money, if I have flat tire, if I got wet in the rain, it's pouring on me in the middle of, whatever happens right now is the best thing that can happen to me. Just because I don't understand it doesn't mean that the reality is different. It's always good for me. If it's good for me, what's the stress for? That's one thing. Second, a person that enjoys life wants to run away from reality? No, he wants the reality to remain forever. All the people who run away by taking pills or smoking or drinking alcohol or sleeping a lot. Some people take sleeping pills. Why do you want to sleep all day? My life is miserable, I don't want to be up. As soon as I wake up, I'm beginning to be sad. So the more I sleep, the less I suffer. If I wouldn't be afraid of God, I would kill myself. And I know it's a horrible sin to commit suicide. So I rather sleep. I sleep until God will take me. That's basically how they think. Some people who they have no God in their life, they kill themselves, they commit suicide. Millions of people kill themselves every year in the world. Why? Give them one reason to live. They have no reason to live. Mm-hmm. But we, Baruch Hashem, we're very lucky. First, from 8 billion people, we are in the 1% of the 1%. The luckiest people. Why? How much is 1% from 8 billion people? 8 billion. How much is 1%? No, more than 8 million. 8 billion, 10% from 8 billion is 800 million. 1% is 80 million. That's 1% of the population of the world. Jews are about 15 million. So it's almost a quarter of the 1%. So we are basically 0.2% from the world. 99.8% are non-Jews. 0.2% are Jews, who dominate the whole world, without a doubt. The anti-Semite screams that every day. Everything is in the hand of the Jews. They control the academy, they control science, control medicine, control religion, control everything. Why? That's the way it's supposed to be. It's written in the book of God. I will scatter you in all the nations, and you will be the highlight of every place. That's what's written. It's 3,300 years ago. It's before we went to exile. It's already a punishment in the Torah. I will throw you in all the nations. The Gemara now say, why we are scattered in all the nations? One of the reasons, besides the punishment, is to make a lot of converts. To show the Gentiles not to be idol worshippers, not to be murderers, not to be all kinds of things that they like to do. That's not the proper way. We have to educate the world. There is one God, there is only one book, there's only one religion, there's only one truth. Everything else is fake. Everything. So the rest is all fake. Why wasting your life on Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism, Krishna, and the rest of the nonsense? Don't waste your life on it. get out of it. You don't have to be Jewish. We're not missionaries. Nobody must be Jewish. No, they can stay Gentiles. You don't have to be righteous. Keep the seven laws. Be decent people. And they go to heaven. Heaven of Gentiles. Much better than the end of the wicked Jews. Right? If you had to choose to be a wicked Jew or a righteous Gentile, what's better? Wicked Jew can end hundreds of years in hell. Or in Kafar Kela. Righteous Gentile doesn't go to hell. Goes to heaven. Yes, it's not the heaven of the Jews, because Jews has a lot more to do. Therefore, the reward is higher. But the punishment is also higher. It works both ways. You see, when you are in an elite unit in the army, some kind of commando, they call in Israel, Yamam, Sayeret Matkal, Shaldag, they have all these names. You cannot just be an ordinary soldier. If you're a driver, driving rice to the kitchen, if you messed up, you didn't show up one day, nobody makes a huge deal out of it. But if you're some kind of elite commando, and all of a sudden you disappear for 24 hours, you may sit in jail for 2 months now. They're gonna make a huge deal out of it. You may say it's discrimination. The cook or the driver got a warning. Nobody did anything to them. I did the same thing. 1 month, 2 months, jail. What's going on? From you, we expect more. From you, we expect a lot more. So why would I need to be Sayeret Matkal? I'd rather be a cook. I'd rather be a driver. I'll be a tailor. Sold some uniform for the soldiers. Why do I need to be in the top elite? The answer is almost every prime minister from Israel was from that unit. Why? With this kind of record, you will succeed later on in your life. You cannot impress anyone by saying that you were a driver in the army. Or you work in a kitchen. Or you were a gardener. Or a tailor. But if you say, I was in Sayeret Matkal, or I was in one of these units, it's like in America, say, I was a SEAL. By the way, they look at you different. It opened doors, even though it's all fake. It's all fake. Don't be impressed by this. Don't think I admire this kind of things. For me, it's all pure nonsense. And the proof for that is in Israel. In Israel, every minister of the army, the security that is in charge of the army, in charge of the security, every one of them was a chief of command before. First he was a chief of the army, then he became a minister in the Knesset that is in charge of security. Except one. There was one guy, Moroccan guy, I doubt if he even was in the army, but if he was in the army, he definitely wasn't chief of command. His name was Amir Peretz. Amir Peretz. He was never a fighter. In my opinion, he doesn't even know how to hold a gun, not to talk about shooting. How do I know? They took him to the mountains of Lebanon, you know, in the border between Israel and Lebanon. They want to show him the Hezbollah. They gave him a military binoculars, you know? And he goes like this. Wow. Yeah, the Hezbollah is very close. While all this time he's pretending to see the terrorists of the Hezbollah, the cops of the... It was closed. He didn't open it. The entire 5 minutes in front of all the reporters taking pictures, Amir Peretz, the chief of command, the head of the army in Israel, is watching the terrorist of the Hezbollah, and the camera is closed. Could be a bigger joke than that. Imagine the Arabs see that now on the TV in Lebanon. Hilarious, they fall on the floor. Look at the Jews, how dumb they are. They pretend to be great soldiers. They brought such a clown to be the minister over there of the army. Doesn't even know how to watch. Terrorist. How is he going to make a decision, right? Sounds terrible, right? We owe Amir Peretz our life. Amir Peretz saved more Jews than all the chief of commands combined. All the big shots from Sayeret Matkal, one by one, all of them combined, did not do 1% of what this Moroccan ignorant did. Who knows what I'm talking about?
The
Iron Dome. When the Arabs started to shoot rockets, hundreds every day, we didn't have the Iron Dome. So the Israelis, now they have to make a decision if to manufacture such a system to protect from the rockets. All the expert generals, what did they say? No! It's not necessary. Too much money. We don't really need it. He was the only one with no military background, nothing, that said, no, we must have it. But he was in charge. All the experts say, no, don't do it. Say, yes, I'm doing it. In the end, it saved the life of thousands of people. It shoots 95% of the missiles in the air. One or two are falling, disaster. Imagine without it what would be. Say 700 missiles falling in the middle of cities. So, who in the end did more than all the experts? The one who have no idea what army is. Why did Hashem do it? To show us never ever to count on the expert in anything. Never to count on the expert doctors, never to count on the expert lawyers, never to count on the ministers, never ever to count on any expert. We do what needs to be done, yes, we do ishtadlut to get safe, but our faith should be only in Hashem. Not in Hashem and someone else. And that's a very common mistake. It's written in Tehillim, I'm sure you read Tehillim from time to time. Arur ha-gever asher yiftach ba-adam. Curse be the person that trusts human being. It doesn't say you should not trust human being. That's what I say. But David HaMelech put a curse on every person, this was 3,000 years ago, that have faith in any human being, including the rabbis. Rabbi will save me. The rabbi can pray for you, give you a blessing, maybe his merit can save your life, yes. But to count that he will save you and not Hashem, that's already heresy. We're not supposed to trust in anyone, not in our boss, and not in our father-in-law, and not your father, and not your nothing, even your own spouse. What's the proof for that? Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah, we read about few women that are all barren. Who? Hannah, Sarah. Hashem pakad et Sarah, right? V'hi achar ha-dvarim ha-ele. This is talking about Avraham and Sarah. And Rachel. Three famous barren women from the Tanakh. Hannah. How many years Hannah was barren? 19 and a half years. 19 and a half years she cried every day praying to Hashem for a child. After 19 and a half years, who did she get? Samuel, Prophet Samuel, which the Gemara say is equal like Moshe and Aaron combined. No joke. Moshe and Aaron on one side of the scale, Shmuel on the other side, greater than both of them. He is a prophet in the time of David HaMelech, in the time of Shaul HaMelech, the time of the big kings. He is a prophet then. Shmuel the prophet, 19 and a half years of prayers until he came to the world. How many years Sarah was barren? She got married when she was 15. Abraham was 25. When did they have a child? 75 years later. She was 90. He was 100. 75 years. Think about it. And Rachel, she passed 36, So she was also, you know, barren for a while, and she comes to Yaakov. Her sister already gave birth to six, one after the other. She has nothing. And why we read about the three barren women on Rosh Hashanah? Yeah, the Gemara gives an answer, because Sarah was became pregnant then. It's because of the date. The date that they conceived was then. But there's a different reason as well. What's mutual between those three women is that their salvation came only after they stopped to trust their husband to save them. As long as they thought, I'm married to a righteous man, he will save me, on purpose Hashem did not give them the salvation. You trust Avraham, go to Avraham to give you kids. You trust Yaakov, go to Yaakov. You trust Elkanah, your husband, go to him to give you kids. If I don't approve it, can he do anything? No. How do we know it? Listen to this. Sarah, she complained to Avraham. Avraham said, I already have a child with Agar. She told him, go, I cannot have kids for you. Go with Agar. He should have said, no, I don't want to go with Agar. I will wait as long as necessary until we will have together a child. Right the way he went, Agar became pregnant. Yaakov, Rachel said to him, give me children, if not, I'm dead. I'm dying. The Gemara said, from here you see that someone who cannot have kids is equal in his mental state like someone that died. That's how bad it is. How do we learn it? From a verse in the Torah. Hava li banim ve'im ayin meta anochi. It doesn't mean physically she's going to die. She said to Yaakov, if I won't have children, look at me as a dead person. I have no reason to live. Tov. So from here we see that Yaakov said to her, what do you want from me? I already have children. The problem is in you. I have children. I have Leah. We have many kids already. Tov. Hannah comes to her husband Elkanah. I want children. Why do you need children? I'm better than 10 kids for you. This is what the answer is. Anochi tov lach me'asara banim. Better you have me, it's better like than to have 10 children. When they realize their husband is not into it, he's not going to do anything for them like they thought, the minute they realize they have only Hashem, that's when the salvation came. And that's what Rav Chaim Mivolozhin said, the student of Gaon Mivilna. In the darkest moment of your life, when things looks very, very bad, cloudy, black, dark, no solution, you have to remember there's a big sgula. What's the sgula? En od lilvado. To think there's nothing but Hashem. No one but Hashem. Nothing but Hashem. Some people, before the goyim kill them, the goyim, they have a minhag. What's the minhag? What is your final request before we kill you? Some rabbi say, I want a glass of water. Glass of water? I'm going to choke you now in a minute. What do you mean, glass of water? Do you worry about being thirsty for the next 30 seconds? It looks like a joke, no? The rabbis really needed a glass of water? Why did they want a glass of water? What do you do when you drink a glass of water? ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהינו מלך העולם שהכל נהיה בדברו. That's all you do. You say, bless you Hashem. Everything that happens based on your word. They're going to hang me now, it's your word. They're going to let me go, it's your word. I'm not begging them. I have no hope that someone will come with guns and save me, the police, nothing. I'm 100% in your hand. It's a wonderful level to be in this level. Think about it. You never have disappointments. Do you know how many disappointments we have in life? why we have so many disappointments? Because we are counting on people, and people usually disappoint. The higher the expectation, the higher the disappointments. You counted on a doctor, nothing happened. You counted on the lawyer, you counted on this, you counted on that. In the end, nothing happened. So you have full of disappointments in life. You have disappointments, disappointed from your partner, from your boss, from your neighbor, from anyone. When you are attached to Hashem and you count on no one, you can never be disappointed. Why? Because if you request something, if you got it, so you're not disappointed. If you didn't get it, you're also not disappointed, because you know Hashem knows better than you what's good for you. So that means, if I begged so much for something and Hashem doesn't think I deserve to get it right now, obviously it's the best thing that can happen to me. So no matter how you look at it, whether you get it, whether you don't get it, there's no reason to be disappointed. How many things in life look like a wonderful gift and in the end it's the end of you? And how many looks like you just lost the greatest chance of your life and in the end it saved your life? How many people missed their flight and in the end it crashed? In every flight that crashed in history, check, there are a few people that in the last minute didn't make it. You know the famous story of that soldier in Israel? There was a very big tragedy, probably one of the biggest in the history of the Israeli army. 71 soldiers crashed in a helicopter crash. 71 soldiers. And one of them, few days before, he got a ride with a religious man. The religious man saw him, you know, looking for a ride. He stopped, he gave him a ride. They started to talk about religion. The soldiers, complete secular. After, he said to him, if I will ask you to do something very simple, very, very easy, but consistently, you'll agree, depend. Every day, when you put off your shoes, put the right one first, then the left, then tie the left first, and then tie the right. First put the right, then put the left, then tie the left first, and then tie the right. The guy said, who cares how I do it? It's already a good start for your day. Why? Right is mercy and kindness. Left is judgment and bad things. Just like today in the world, righties and lefties. All the bad is on the left, all the good always on the right side. You don't find anything good in the left, just bad. Same thing in life. The Kabbalah is teaching us, right, zeh chesed, kindness, mercy. Left is judgment. All the evil things, left. The soldier heard that. Tov, but you promise? Every day. Why? Mitzvah goreret mitzvah. One mitzvah leads to another one. If you do something, Hashem will open you another opportunity. The soldiers, the helicopters came to take them home. They were in the field. They're taking them home now. All of them gathered in one area. Two helicopters landed. He just remembered that he didn't put his shoes in the right way. And he was embarrassed to take the shoes in front of all the officers there. He said, I need to go to the bathroom. I said, come on, we're in a rush. We have to take off. Give me 2 minutes. He ran. Where is he? Where is he? The general there got angry. Say, you know what? We'll teach him a lesson. He's gonna stay in the base. Go! Come on, wait for him. Nobody is waiting for anyone. Go! A minute later, they crashed with each other, all of them died. And he's the only one who got saved. Wow. It's a very famous story. What saved his life? Accepted on himself one tiny mitzvah. One tiny mitzvah. What's the big deal? How you put your shoes on? Who cares? The mitzvah was so great to save the life? No, it's not such an important mitzvah. It's not the end of the world if someone doesn't do it in the right way. Aval, it's the consistency. I'm willing to do something for the religion. Even though I'm personally not religious, I will start, I gave my word and I'm going to keep my word. And he went to change the clothes, to the shoes, take him off and do it in the right way. While he was doing it, you know how it is, sometimes it doesn't open, the knot. Hashem arranged it. So Rabotai, once you know the Tehillim say, Arur, a gever asher iftach ba'adam, Arur is like the curse of the snake. Arur atam kol chayat asadeh. You are the most cursed animal from all the animals in the field. How many animals we know today by names? Who knows? 2 million. 2 million names. I bet you don't even know 200. Not that I know. I'm just in general. If I tell you to name now 200 kind of animals, you wouldn't probably be able to, no?
Yes.
2 million, thousands of different kinds of monkeys, so many different kinds of bears, so many different kinds of insects. Wow, you know how many kinds of snakes alone you have? If you add it all together, 2 million. And the snake is the worst out of everyone, cursed. Snakes and the dogs. Snakes and the dogs. But the snake, it's written in the Torah that is cursed more than all other animals. The dog, we learn it from a verse. What's the verse? The Torah says, if you replace a dog with a sheep, you make an exchange. You go to someone, I have a dog, you have a sheep. I want to take a sheep to Beit HaMikdash, to the temple, to sacrifice, to Hashem. I cannot sacrifice the dog. So the dog worth $500, the sheep worth $500, let's do an exchange. Take my dog, give me instead a sheep. Fair deal, no? You took the sheep, Hashem said, I'm not interested in that sheep. An exchange from a dog, do not dare to bring to my house. From here we learn that Hashem cannot stand the dogs. You may say, wait a minute, but the dogs are very loyal. They save life, they smell bombs, they take care of the sheep, right? The shepherd is using dogs, they help him a lot. There are many, many good things. Blind people, the dogs help them to take them around. They smell the drugs. They go in a combat against the mass murderers, terrorists. They jump to them, bite their hands, knock down the guns from their hand. They save the life of many people. So there are so many wonderful things the dogs do. Probably I didn't even name 1% of the things they do. So when we say that the dog is the worst, we are not talking about physically. We're talking about spiritually. Every living creature have a spiritual level. Like you have Kohen, and you have Levi. Who is higher? Kohen is higher. A little bit higher spiritually. As a raw material, spiritually. Kohen automatically is higher than Levi. Levi automatically is higher than Israel. Israel automatically higher than a Gentile. Gentiles, there are different levels. Some of them, like Amalek, are the worst one. Some are not idol worshippers, so they're not as bad. Meaning even among the Goyim, there are many, many different levels. Same thing with the animals. Some animals are in a higher spiritual level, like cows, sheep, all the kosher animals that the Torah named. Same thing with the birds. Some of them are kosher. What's the difference between the kosher animal and the non-kosher animals? The non-kosher animals are murderers. They murder in order for them to survive. Like lions, tigers, crocodiles, they rip the neck, they gore the person, the victim that they attack. The kosher animals are the ones who've been murdered. They're not the murderers. Sheep does not murder. Cows do not murder. They don't eat other animals. They only eat grass. Deer eat grass. Giraffe eat grass. All the kosher animals, none of them is a murderer. Same thing by the birds. The murderers are forbidden to be eaten. The non-murderers, some of them, not all of them, are permitted to us. Meaning, you see, there are animals, the Torah called them pure, tahor, and some animals, the Torah called them tmeah, tameh. Tameh means impure. But the only, every animal is born with a status, whether it's tameh or tahor, and it stays for life. If you born a sheep, you tahor for life. If you born a pig, you tameh for life. If you're a donkey, you tameh for life. There's no such thing for an animal one time to be tahor and one time to be tameh. Only by Jews you have this option. A Jew can be, is born tahor, and he can become tameh. A woman, she gets her period, she became impure, spiritually. Nothing to do with how clean or not clean. She can take 5,000 showers, creams, clean herself with alcohol. It does, we're not talking about cleanness here. We're talking about a spirit. Once the Torah said that something happened in a body, or that you touch something, or you were around a dead body, there are different kinds of impurity. Once a person did that, the spirit of impurity is now on him. The only way to get rid of that bad spirit is to go into natural water, which is mikveh, or a lake, or in the ocean. Why? Because spirit cannot enter water. They stay above. Once the body goes in, with now separation, if you have clothes and this, then some of the skin will not be wet. That means the spirit is holding to that place. But if you go completely in, the water touched the entire body in one shot. That's why they clean the ears before and all kinds of things. Make sure there's no loose air. Why? Once you go in and out, you become pure, but not everything. If you touch a dead body, you go into the mikveh, you're still impure. For that, it's a higher impurity. It's not enough mikveh, like nida. For this, you need ashes of a red cow with natural water, combination of two things. Big secrets, we have no idea. Red cow, the concept of red cow to purify the people that touch dead bodies or were in a cemetery or someone died in a room where they were or in a hospital. That's it. Most likely all of us are impure. Tmei metim. If we had now red cow, ashes of a red cow, and we put it on an impure person, meaning every one of us, you won't be able to tell, you will be shocked from your holiness before and after. Right now it's so hard to understand, so hard to remember because of this tumat met. Once you get rid of the tumat met, you have a whole different channel of life. You're a complete different person. The impurity spiritually makes a huge damage. They made in France some experiments. You know, when you go to the vineyards in France, they make the best wines in the world, Italian, French, they know how to make wine. The Israelis in recent years also starting to win all kinds of awards, but it's known for hundreds of years that the French are very good with wine. When you go to the vineyards, they have a sign there. Women that have their period are not allowed to go in. Why? They realize, without knowing Torah, it's nothing to do with religion. They realize that this kind of impurity, they don't look at it as impurity. They just look at it as a woman in this situation can damage the wine. They made also in Israel an experiment. They put fresh flowers, a woman touched it, right away, within hours, the flower died. And the other flowers that she didn't touch, they survived a few days. Why? You see that this impurity also affecting us physically. It's written in the Gemara. The Gemara say, when you make the perfumes, the spices, that gives good smell for the ketoret, He say adek etev etev adek mipnei shehakol yafe la besamim. When you make perfume, make the place noisy. If there is noise, it improves the quality of the smell. When you make wine, it has to be complete silence. The more noise over there, the worse the wine become. Has to, that's why they do it deep in the ground, underneath. No one goes, it's quiet all the time. You see, there is a spiritual effect on the things. Once you hear voice, or for some things it's good, for some it's bad. I'll give you one example. I don't know if you know it by now, but trees, they have eyes and ears and language and even feelings. Feelings. The Gemara talks about two trees in Galilee, in Israel, that were in love with each other. One is in love with the other gives fruit. The one that is in love does not give any fruit. So the Chachamim say, take a branch from there, mix it together with the one who doesn't give fruit, and right away it's going to give plenty of dates. So what do you see from here? That the Chachamim were already aware that trees have feelings. The Gemara say, Hillel HaZaken had 80 students. The greatest one was Yonatan ben Uziel. The last one on the list from the 80 was Yochanan ben Zakkai, which was the president of Israel in the destruction of the second temple when the Romans came. 3 years they made siege around Jerusalem. And he was the president at that time. And in these 3 years, there were 3 billionaires that had so much food that they gave enough food for all the people of Jerusalem for 3 years. And they still had plenty left. What happened? Disagreement among the Jews. Some wanted to surrender, some didn't want to surrender. The bullies, they went and burned all the leftover food. And that's what created all the problems, the destruction and everything. But what do we see from here? Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai was the last one from the 80 in the list. And he was so great. He was the president. The Gemara says he knew the language of the angels, the language of the animals, the language of the trees. Meaning he knew how the trees communicate with each other. We lost this wisdom. We don't have it. Who had this wisdom? King Solomon. King Solomon had all the wisdoms in the world. Some of them were shared to others, and eventually all of it gone. There is a midrash that once the Goyim came and destroyed the first temple that King Solomon built, they stole all his library, all his great books that he wrote, in all the wisdom scattered among the nations. That's why some of the Goyim are good with kishufim, black magic, all kinds of things in India, in China. They have all kinds of wisdoms that were scattered all over the world. So I give you an example. I have in Israel, I planted 2 trees. One orange, one lemon. A few months later, the lemon started to grow, started to have lemons. First 3 years, you're not allowed to cut any of the fruits, right? You leave it full of lemons. Good smell, beautiful look. The orange one, growing, doesn't give one orange. 1 year, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 full years, now one orange grows. It became a huge tree, huge. The lemon also is huge, but gives hundreds of lemons every year. The orange, not one. I say, wow, it's catching so much room here. No benefit in this tree. I say to my assistant, I say to him, look what's going on with this tree. The other ones give plenty, this one doesn't give anything. He said to me, what's the problem? Threaten him. I said, what? Tell him that if he doesn't start giving fruits, next time you come to Israel, you chop him off. thought he's joking with me. You and your jokes. So, no, no, it's not a joke. 100% reliable. We had one like this in a shul. Mango. Ears, not one mango grew. Everybody waits for the mangoes in the shul. Nothing is growing. One guy came, said to the mango tree, listen, this is your last chance. Or you start growing mangoes, or we get rid of you. Few months later, I was packed with mangoes. I was still skeptic, you know. Ah, come on, threatening him. So I looked around and nobody sees. 12 o'clock at night. Imagine they look at me talking to a tree. I looked around, no one looks. I said to him, listen, dear Balak, you better start giving us oranges, or next time I come to Israel, we get rid of you. Tov, I didn't take it serious. I said, what do I have to lose? I talked to the tree 1 minute. I go back to New York. 3 months later, I come back to Israel. I walk, I see the tree full of purple flowers. I say, oh, mom, where? Mamash like this, Aron Kodesh, you see? That on the top, the same color, flowers. Male, tons of it. I say, how flowers grow on a tree all the way to the top? Maybe there was another plant that started to climb on a tree. I'm thinking to myself, well, this maybe came from the neighbor's top. I walk near the tree. I get the shock of my life. Full of oranges. Every branch, tons of oranges. Not so big. They're still growing. Next time they're gonna be already, they're still green. Mm-hmm. I cannot be. I called my guy, Avishai. You won't believe what happened. The tree is full of flowers and oranges. So I told you, what do you? You didn't even get surprised. Badukum nuse. What do you see from here? The words of the Gemara 2,000 years ago. Trees. The Gemara said, when you chop a tree, he's screaming, goes from one side of the world to the other side of the world. It was written 2,000 years ago. Now I want to ask you, when we chop a tree, do you hear any screaming?
No.
Why not?
It's not a physical scream.
Because Hashem made the ear work in a different frequency than the screaming of the tree. So your ear cannot hear it. There are certain things the animals can hear and we cannot hear. But the question that I have is, why Hashem made our ear be able to hear some animals, let's say, but we cannot hear the language of the trees or when the trees scream?
We'll hear every second.
We won't be able to survive. That saved us. If our ear would hear the tree screaming, imagine you take an ox, boom, you hit the tree, ah, scream, no. Nobody would chop trees, you won't have houses, you won't have furniture, you won't have anything. Who would dare to chop a tree? I mean, come on, it's like a murder. It's like doing it to an animal. If you come to an animal with an ox, hear him in the middle of his stomach. What would happen? Screaming, barking, crying. No one is able to do such thing. It will be the same feeling. You hit the tree, you hear the screams. No one would ever cut trees. No furniture, no wood, no tables, no chairs, no nothing. So Hashem made it in such a way that we won't hear it because it was given to us to use it. This is just another example. We go back to what I started. So, Rabotai, after Rosh Hashanah and Kippur comes Sukkot. Why Sukkot comes now? It should have been in the spring. We should have had Pesach and Sukkot combined. Pesach, the Torah said that must always come in the spring. Chag Aviv, Pesach. Pesach, Chag Aviv, the holiday of the spring. Why is the holiday of the spring? Because Hashem wanted Pesach to be exactly just like it was when the Exodus of Egypt, in a beautiful weather. That's why every 19 years we push 7 more months into the calendar. Every 2 to 3 years, when Pesach is falling short around March in Israel, it's still cold, we push 1 more month into the calendar manually and postpone Pesach by 30 days. Now it's going to fall around April. April is already nice and warm. Another 2-3 years, Pesach is falling short, we push another month. How many months? 9 months. 7 months in 19 years. 7 months every 19 years, extra 7 months. So that means there are few years that are 13 months in a Jewish calendar. Why do we have to do it? Because the difference between the year of the sun and the year of the moon is 11 days and change. So that means every 3 years, the time comes a month earlier. Every 3 years it's 33 days. That means if Passover now will be April 15, after 3 years it will be March 15. March 15 is still cold. It's not the spring. So Hashem wanted Pesach to be in the spring. Why Sukkot is not in the spring? Sukkot is the beginning of the winter. In Israel, usually the first rains are always on Sukkot, even though this year was 2 weeks earlier. I don't know if you heard my, if you listened to my lectures in Hebrew, then you know that story. I had a lecture all the way in the north. And over there are two graves of very holy people. One is Chonia Me'agel and his grandson Abba Chilkia. So I arrived, you leave Israel from Rehovot all the way to the north, sometimes it will be 2.5 hours, sometimes it can be 4 hours, depending on the traffic. You cannot take a risk. So I arrived 7:15. 7:15, and the lecture is 8:15. So we have almost an hour. So they say to me, go to the grave of Chonia Me'agel, it's right here, a mile from here. So, wow, perfect opportunity. I went to the grave, I'm with my assistant. We go to Kever Chonia Me'agel, we daven there 10-15 minutes, then we go to the next grave. Who is the next grave? His grandson, Abba Chilkia. What's special about those two? They were able to bring rain right away. You don't have people like this in the world today. Meaning, if they talk to Hashem, the rain begins. If you remember, in many of my lectures, I spoke about the Gemara that speaks about Abba Chilkia, how he was working in the field, and the Beit Din sent messengers to talk to him, that he should daven for rain. And then they went to his house and his wife came out when she's all dressed up. You remember that story or no? So I'm going to the grave of Abba Chilkia. This is August. It's never rain in Israel in August. Never. If any, it's around September, end of September, even middle of September, but never in the middle of August. It's totally summer. It's 110 degrees every day. Hot, very hot and humid. So I go to the grave of Abba Chilkia. I pray over there. I said, Abba Chilkia, Baruch Hashem, I spoke about you in many of my lectures. A lot of people knows about you. There was a lot of Kiddush Hashem. Maybe you ask Hashem to help us with this, with that. I have a list of requests. Now, before I left, I had an idea. So since he's an expert on bringing rain, speaks to Hashem, and rain comes. I say, if you agree to help me out and speak to Hashem on my behalf, please give us a sign that we'll have a little rain today. What do we have to lose? I go, I give the lecture, 11 o'clock at night, I'm done there. We're heading back to the south. As we drive, I said to the guy, you know, I had a very good davening in Abba Chilkia's grave. I said, if you're willing to help, please bring rain today. So the guy started to laugh. Rain, my rain. August, that's not America. Every week you have rain. Over here, 6-7 months, there's no rain. No chance for rain. It's okay, I know, I know. Rabotai, 5 minutes. 5 minutes as we drive on the highway, I begin to see on the windshield. I say, do you see what's happening here? I say, it cannot be. The guy is starting to shake. It cannot be. Another minute, pouring rain. Wow. The windshield wipers on the fastest speed, pouring rain for 10 minutes. In the middle, I say, such miracles. It's against all odds. Go check in the history of Israel in the last 100 years if it ever rained in August. Probably. To the best of my knowledge. I mean, I don't know the history, but you see, Rabotai, sometimes Hashem gives you mamash in front of your eyes, clear miracle. That's why they say when you go to the grave of the tzaddikim, chas v'shalom, you're not allowed to pray to them, and not God or anything. You have to just ask their help to be a good lawyer for you. Why? Sometimes you come to court, the judge doesn't know who you are. It's very cold to you. But if you come with a lawyer that every judge knows already, 30 years in the courtroom, he's already saw him many, many times in his room, and he likes him, as soon as your lawyer begins to talk on your behalf, the attitude of the judge is starting to change. But that's only correct if you're not an Orthodox Jew. If you're an Orthodox Jew, you bring anyone you want, even the judge's wife and his mother and everyone. He looks at a religious person like he saw the devil. That's how they are, these lefty judges. There is no chance whatsoever to get a fair trial to a religious Jew in Israel. Zero chance. Not 1%. Zero chance. They do whatever they want. They don't care about the law. They see you, it's mamash like a Nazi see a Jew. That's how it is, the same attitude. When you begin to talk, they shut you off like this. You bring proofs, they don't even look at it. They don't even try to hide it. My lawyer just told me, you know, with this lawsuit of that prime minister joker. So my lawyer said to me, you know what upsets me the most? I mean, I didn't expect him to take your side. He's a lefty. This is the hero. He moved 200,000 votes from the right, stole them and moved them to the left. He became their number one hero. So I'm not worried about this. I already knew that it's not going to be a fair trial. What bothers me the most is that they used to try to hide it. And now they're not even trying even a bit to hide it. In your face, they tell you, we are against you. It doesn't matter. You're going to lose. From the first minute. Zero, no fair trial. Think about it. Imagine you go to a courtroom, you have a racist judge. Imagine, let's say you're a black person. As soon you go into the thing, he sees that you're black, he hates black, right away begins to attack you. He doesn't care about what you say, he doesn't care what papers you have. Immediately, he put an X on you. Or the other way around. A black judge see white people, immediately goes against them. And he doesn't even open, doesn't cover it. In your face, I hate you. Why? Because you're such and such and such. That's very bad, but it's also good. Why it's good? Right now we suffer from them. But it's according to what the Gemara say, that before the end of days, the Mashiach, who is going to control Israel? The souls of the Erev Rav that came out of Egypt. The filthiest souls. It's written, the Gaon Mivilna said that those neshamot are neshamot Amalek. Wow. Mamash neshamot Amalek. And you wonder, why Amalek wants to kill Jews? We never had a mutual border with them. It's not like two countries, they had a border, so they fight. They fight. There's reasons why they fight. Export, import, taxes, property, something. A nation from the end of the world, like Iran. What do they have to do with Israel? Why? They hate Jews. So they found that they have to put all their effort just to get a bomb that they can get rid of Israel. That's it. Why do we don't have a mutual border with you. What do we have to do with you? I understand you fight with Iraq, you fight with your neighbors, but what do you have to do with us? Nothing. It's a war, Islam against Judaism. There's nothing else. We're not threatening them in any way. We're not near them. We're not trying to occupy them. There's no really no reason. Why? These Khomeinis, these Ayatollahs, that's all they care about. They found an excuse, Palestinian. What do they have to do with Palestinians? What do they have to do with the Palestinians? These Persians and the Arabs, the enemies. Arabs and Persians are enemies. Look at the Arab world. Almost every country is an enemy of Iran. What all of a sudden they care about the Palestinians? The answer, no. They're just going to do the job for us. We hire them, we give them money, kill Jews. Until we'll be able to have a bomb. That's the idea here. Same thing Amalek. We came out of Egypt. Who showed up? Amalek. No matter what, on the way, Amalek is always attacking us. That's why there's mitzvah in the Torah that Hashem's chair will never be complete until Amalek will be wiped out from the world. As long as they are in the world, it's like, in a way, it's like a defect in the chair of Hashem. It's metaphoric. Meaning, a king has a chair, but the chair is incomplete. Why? Because his enemies are still around. The chair will always be complete only when the enemies will not be around. And this is basically the struggle we have for the 3,300 years. So Rabotai, the question is why Sukkot came right now, in the beginning of the winter? That's not the Exodus of Egypt, and the Sukkot is a memory of what we had in the desert. Sukkot, the Gemara gives two reasons. One, we actually literally had Sukkot. We lived in Sukkot in the desert. Two, the Sukkah is mainly for the Schach, the top. The top is instead of the clouds, the Anenei HaKavod, the clouds that used to make shed, protect us from the sun, and guarding us while we were 40 years in the desert. As a result of that, we sit in a sukkah, and the shed inside the sukkah must come from the top, not from the walls. That's why you're not allowed to build a sukkah too high. If you make the walls too high, the reason that it's dark in a sukkah is not because of the schach, it's because the high walls are blocking the sun. But if the sukkah is low, almost to your height, the sun can penetrate from the top. That's why you need to put the schach. It has to be something that grows naturally. Cannot put metal or aluminum. Or it has to be things that naturally grows in the ground, like bamboos. They make special mats with things that grows in the ground. It has to be natural. It's not recommended to chop branches from trees and put it because they're full of worms and bugs. And they can fall into your food. Some of them are mamash very tiny. So if you have a salad, let's say you put a big bowl of salad, it's almost guaranteed in the 2 hours that you sit in the sukkah that from the schach, some worms will fall into your salad. Or flies that come right into why? Because those kinds of branches brings all kinds of flies. That's why we rather put dry things like bamboos or mats, that it doesn't attract insects. Now there is a big mitzvah. Every night there is a different visitor in a sukkah. First night Avraham, second night Yitzchak, third night Yaakov, fourth night Moshe, Aaron, David, Yosef is the sixth one, and David. Every day we do one circle around the Sefer Torah when we do Hoshana. Oh, Hoshana, right, with the Lulavim. The last day of Sukkot, before Shmini Atzeret, it's called Hoshana Rabba, big Hoshana. Why? We do seven circles for all seven in one shot. We stay up all night. Why? Because the judgment that was sealed on Yom Kippur is still a little bit open for changes. Rosh Hashanah was the verdict. Yom Kippur was an opportunity to appeal and fix things up to Yom Kippur. Yom Kippur, the judge, Hashem, seal, sign, the verdict. That's it. Tfilat Ne'ilah, the last hour of Yom Kippur, it's the final chance. Not exactly. There is still a few more days that you can do it until Hoshana Rabbah. That's why we stay up all night. Just like the night of Shavuot, we stay on Hoshana Rabbah. And if you pay attention, in the middle of the night, we do slichot. Rachamana, Rachamana, Rachamana. Hashem Melech, Hashem Malach, Shema Yisrael. We learn different parts of the Torah. Between one part to another, we do a few minutes slichot. Then we daven Netz Minyan in sunrise. We start about half an hour before. We aim that the Tfilat Amidah will be exactly in sunrise. And this is a very long davening. It's about 3 hours. Why? Just the seven hakafot alone is more than an hour. Seven, it's a lot to read. It's not easy after being up all night. That's why tomorrow you're gonna go to sleep. At least 4, 5, 6 hours to sleep that you'll be able to be up all night. You won't be able to go to work tomorrow, come back an hour before Yom Tov, tired already from work, and now stay for the meal, go to shul, daven, come home, do the meal, and now stay up until 9 o'clock the next morning. It'll be impossible. That's why we must sleep, we have to rest. At night we love to drink coffee, this, that, fine. I mean, that's not enough. If you're not gonna rest tomorrow during the day, you won't be able to survive the night. This is just the heads up. Now, why we say Hoshana? We should have said Hoshiana. Why we say Hoshana? Hoshana. That's not the proper language. You can say Hoshana, but it's not the... Usually you have to say Hoshiana, Ana Hashem Hoshiana. Right? We say Ana Hashem Hoshiana, Ana Hashem Atzlichana. Why all of a sudden it became Hoshana? How much in numeric value, Hoshana, how much is this? Hey, it's 5. Vav, it's 6. 11. Shin is how much? Huh? 300. But without the zeros. It's called Gimatria Ktana. So 11 plus 3, right? How much? 14. Ayin is how much?
70.
70 minus the zero, so it's 7. 7. So 11 plus 3 is 14, plus 7, 21. Na? 50. Right? 51. So you take off the 0, so it's 6 and 1, 7. How much is that together?
28.
Hoshana. 28. Something didn't add up correctly. The calculation should be 51. We'll redo it later, but 51, and the reason it's 51, because from Rosh Hashanah, from Rosh Chodesh Elul, until the Hoshana Rabbah, until Shmini Atzeret, all together 51 days. That's why they made it in such a numeric value. Now the question is, why did Hashem made Sukkot so early and not in the time of the spring? The answer is that it should be very close to the judgment day. Why we have to do Sukkot close to the judgment day? Because one of the way to repent is to go to exile, to leave your home and go to a place that is not your home. You sleep there, you eat there. Kicking you out of your house, it comes for some of the sins that the punishment in the Torah is to go to exile. So instead of going really to exile, leave your town, leave your family, and go to an isolated country somewhere, symbolically we go out and we sit in a Torah, in a Sukkah, and that's count like redemption. Why? It's considered an exile. Now the question is, Shmini Atzeret, which comes tomorrow night. In Israel it's only one day. One day holiday, Shmini Atzeret, and night. Tomorrow, not tomorrow, the next day at night in Israel, it's already a weekday. That's when they do Simchat Torah. On the streets, with music, with cars. They start Simchat Torah in the Shmini Atzeret. But the main celebration is in the end of the one-day holiday. Here we have 2 days holidays. So all the Simchat Torah is in the second day. Without music, without bands, without electric, without cars, in the synagogue, big parties, Simchat Torah. Before we get to Simchat Torah, Shmini Atzeret, it's a part of Sukkot, or it's a holiday by itself?
It's a holiday by itself.
How do you know it's a holiday by itself?
Because we don't say the Shabbat Sukkah.
We don't say Lishem Basukah because of a doubt. It's not guaranteed. We don't know 100%. Because remember, the Sukkot, you have 2 days Yom Tov. If we start counting from the first day, then you're right. Shmini Atzeret is already Sukkot finished. But if we start counting from the second day, then it's still Sukkot. It's still Sukkot. So because we know we're not sure, that's why we do 2 days Yom Tov, because of the doubt. So therefore, we don't say bracha, but we sit in a sukkah. And we sleep in a sukkah the first night. We don't make bracha, but we're still in a sukkah. The second day, we're not anymore in a sukkah. The question that I have right now is, Shmini Atzeret, the Torah say that in the 8th day, of Sukkot, Atzeret Yelachem. There is another holiday that is called Atzeret. Who knows which one? Which Atzeret?
Shavuot.
Shavuot. How many days you have between Pesach and Shavuot? 50 days. 50 days. Why there is no 50 days between Sukkot and Shmini Atzeret? It should be the same Atzeret. Why it's attached? The answer is because Hashem did not want to have us suffering too much. It's too much of a burden. What does it mean? People come to Jerusalem when the temple was there from all over Israel on horses and donkeys. To go from Tiberias all the way to Jerusalem, it's 2 weeks to get there and 2 weeks to come back. Imagine you and your children with few donkeys or a carriage. There's no roads like today. There was no BMW and Bentleys yet. So you came on an old donkey or a horse or something. By the time you get to Jerusalem, 2 weeks. Then you stay a week, then 2 weeks to come back, 5 weeks you're out of your business. Out of your family, out of your home. The women usually didn't come. It's only the father and the boys. It was hard to get everyone, the sisters, the girls. It's not like today, you go in a truck, rent a truck, everyone goes, no problem. So now, you come to Jerusalem, you celebrate Sukkot there, Simchat Bet HaShoeva, the Chachamim make all kinds of jugglings, and unbelievable, the Gemara describes what happened in the temple. It was the greatest feelings a person can have. Lots of light, everyone together, everyone religious. It's wonderful. Now you have to go back. If Shmini Atzeret, instead of being Shmini, would be an Atzeret like Shavuot, you finish Sukkot, just like you finish Pesach, right? So from Pesach to Shavuot, how many days you have? From the first day of Pesach, you have 50 days. Take off 7, 43 days left. Wow. So imagine now, by the time you get home, you have to hit the road again. Not realistic. So you may say, well, I just arrived to Tzfat. Now I have to stay home a day or two and go back to Jerusalem. It's not possible. So what did Hashem do? Cut the break, attached Shmini Atzeret, and made it attached to Sukkot. Now let's see who is clever here. There is a problem with this theory. It's not a theory, it's a fact, but something here doesn't add up. No? It doesn't bother you?
Why didn't you do that in the first one?
Huh?
Why did you do the same thing?
Yeah. Why Hashem didn't do the same thing in Shavuot? Atrat Shavuot, the last day of Pesach. Shvi Shel Pesach will be Shavuot. Right now, sending everyone home, and everybody comes back to Yerushalayim on Shavuot.
To get ready.
It's one of the three regalim. The answer is, Rabotai, because it's already beautiful, spring. It's a nice trip. I want you to come to Jerusalem. Beautiful weather, everywhere, warm, nothing, and there's no rain. But Sukkot is the beginning of the rain. If you have to be 1 or 2 weeks on the road to get to Yerushalayim, there's no way to avoid the rain. Can't be 4 weeks on the road and not getting rain pouring on you and your children. That's already too much to ask. I don't want to ruin your holidays in the preparation. So when it's raining, I give you a discount. I attach the two holidays that in one trip, you cover both. But Pesach, it's wonderful. Everything is growing, everything is blooming. Enjoy it. Plus Shavuot, you don't have to stay a week. You stay a day or two and you come back. So it's wonderful. Why? Because Shavuot, you know, it's not so long, so you come. Some people, it's not 2 weeks. Some people live not far, Lud, Ramle. Can be 2 or 3 days and they get there. Those who are very far, it's only a different story. Now I want to tell you something, I don't know if you know it. How many years there was a temple in Jerusalem? How many years? First temple, how many years it stood there?
410 years.
The second temple, how many years?
420.
Together, 830. Now we have in each year 3 regalim. Sukkot, Pesach, Shavuot. Based on the calculation I just did, which takes almost a month to get there and to come back, would stay there. Instead of 5 weeks, let's make it a month, because Shavuot, you don't stay a week. So Shavuot is just back and forth. You have approximately 3 months of the year you don't work. You're not at a job. You're on the road and celebrating in Jerusalem. There is no army in the borders between us and Lebanon, Syria, all these countries. They were always our enemies. Aram, all this, it's the same area. Nineveh, all these places in the north, in the Jordan area, Babylonians, this, they're all around in the Middle East. They all hate us. Everybody knows the Torah, because the Torah was translated to 70 languages. So they all see that we live all over Israel, and all the men from Bar Mitzvah and up are all in Jerusalem. There's not one soldier left. No policemen, no soldiers, no army, no guards, no nothing. Everybody leaves everything, they must go. You don't leave soldiers. The Torah says, I give you my word. Whenever you're on the way to Jerusalem to celebrate the 3 festivals, no goy will ever attack your land in those periods of time. Meaning now you're 1 month busy with the mitzvah of Pesach, the goyim will never attack you in that month. You're 1 month busy with Sukkot, nobody will attack you. You're busy with Shavuot, no one will attack you. Between, there will be plenty of wars. But you'll be ready for them. But when all of you are in Jerusalem, I will make sure to numb the goyim. They're numb now. Numbing. Sleeping. How can it be that the goyim are so dumb? They don't know there's no soldier, just let's walk into Israel and take it? Without a war, without one bow and arrow, without fight, just walk into Israel. Move into the homes, occupy every house, kick the women out, or put them in capture. By the time the man comes back, they find out, we took all over Israel. 830 years, multiplied by 3 months, of every year, how many months there was no guards? How many months? Do the calculation. 830 times 3. How much is that? Almost 2,500 months. Minus 10. Almost 2,500 months. 2,500. Do you know what it means, 2,500 months? 1 month and another month and another month. All together, we're talking years. How many years? Who can tell me? How many years? About 200 and something years. A third of 830. 830 divided by 3 is how much? Too much, the math, huh? It's almost 300 years. Almost 300 years if you attach all the months together. 300 years, not one attack by the goyim. But between the holidays, one attack after the other. Can you believe such thing? What do you think? Now, Rabotai, if the goyim will attack us when we are in Jerusalem in Passover or in Sukkot, there would be the end of Judaism. No more religion. No more Hashem, no more nothing. Who knows why? Because you can never have errors in the Torah. Cannot have mistakes in the Torah. The Torah promise, count on me. Go to Jerusalem, enjoy the holiday. לא יחמוד גוי את ארצך בעלותך לראות את פני השם אלוקיך. No nation of goyim will desire your land when you come to see me in Jerusalem. And the goyim reads it in the Torah. How come now one goy say, let's do it on purpose to prove to them that their religion is nothing? They will kill two birds with one stone. One, they'll cancel Judaism. And two, they'll occupy Israel with one transaction. Moving into Israel would be the first mistake in the Torah. And we would lose Israel. So we lost our religion and we lost our country. 2,500 months, not one group of goyim thought about it. You see that they're not doing so bad when they come to war. Israel lose to the Arabs 40 years already straight. From the last victory was the Six-Day War, which was how many years ago? 1967. You do the math. It's 56 years. 56 years we lose to the Arabs in every battle. Everyone. Shlomo Galil, we lost. All the operations with Hamas, we beg for ceasefire. Right away. Start 2-3 days, Bibi. No, no, Egypt, please help us. Why? Cowards. Zero courage. Every prime minister is afraid. Why? He knows to go into Gaza, you're going to have 1,000 Israeli soldiers die in 1 week, minimum. They have booby traps, they have bunkers. These Arabs, this Hamas is like the devil. They have traps. They make you go into a house, and while all the soldiers there, they blow up the whole building. Plus, they use children. They put the children in front. They hide beside them because they know the Israelis won't shoot the kids. And that's how they gather. They go into places. Or they hide all their weapon in kindergarten that no one can attack there, because the whole world would say, wow, look at the Israeli army. They're attacking kindergartens. They have lousy tricks. They don't go by the book. And they put all kinds of traps when you go with the tanks and everything, boom, tanks goes on. Today, just today, they burned a big, big truck. You had to see hundreds of them throwing Molotov cocktail bottles. The whole truck was on fire. And they continued to throw. The truck is all on fire. There's nothing left. They have so much hate. They continue to throw rocks into the truck. There's no one there. The truck is on fire. They continue, hundreds of them, throwing rocks. So much hate to us. So they know how to fight. They learn. They learn the lousiest tricks. But for 2,000, For 830 years, excuse me, 830 years, not, there was that dumb. They didn't think to attack. There's nobody there, there's no army, there's no borders. Just walk in and take the land. When Hashem wants the goyim to sit and be quiet, they won't make a beep. Don't think they think about things on their own. When Hashem wants a Holocaust, it takes a crazy person. Adolf, wake up. Look what's happening. Gives him all kinds of ideas against the Jews, drives him crazy. He begins to scream, thousands of others joining him. 2 years, 3 years later, you saw what happened. Same thing with Arabs. When we didn't have to suffer from Iran, there was the Shah, his father, beautiful. We were the best friends with Iran. Hashem decided to teach us a lesson, brought Khomeini from France into Iran. 40 years, they don't give us a rest a minute. Everything in Israel is the fear from Iran. I wonder if Iran will have a nuclear bomb. Do you think they will throw it on Israel or no? So one person told me, no, they won't kill all the Palestinians. I was trying very hard not to laugh. They won't kill. They hate the Palestinians as much as they hate us. But right now, they're using them to do their job. If they have a nuclear bomb, the Palestinians are the last factor that they will take to consideration. Not even the mosque. Remember, Shiite, Sunni, they hate each other just as much as they hate us. So the answer is, if Hashem Chas V'Shalom will decide yes, yes. If Hashem will decide no, it will explode in our face. It's all dependent on Hashem. Are you afraid of Iran or are you afraid of Hashem? The Satan is confusing us. We are afraid from the wrong source. Iran is only the stick in the hand of Hashem. There's nothing going to happen from Iran without Hashem's approval. United States, it is another stick in the hand of Hashem. When Trump was there, it was very nice. The stick hit very, very gentle. Now these Democrats are in power. The stick is working extra, day and night, and it's very painful. It's almost like an enemy. Everything against us, everything is Palestinians. Trump closed everything Palestinian. Nothing, no embassy, no nothing. They came right away, they changed everything around. Depends what Hashem wants. If Hashem wants us to continue to suffer, the same sleepy Joe, who by now doesn't even know what's his name, will stay another 4 years. And Hashem will keep him alive just for that. And if you think that it will be better to get rid of him, think again, because there are some in a Democratic Party that are a lot worse than him. A lot worse. Let's not fall in their hands. As long as he's alive, as in Hebrew we have an expression, Ara b'miuto. Ara b'miuto. It's bad, it could have been a lot worse. So Rabotai, we have now the days of Sukkot. It's kind of like an exile. And there is one mitzvah in a Sukkot. Very important mitzvah, to invite guests. To invite guests. Many people, they only want to stay together. They don't want guests. It's mitzvah in Sukkot, mitzvah achnasat orchim. More than other holidays. In Pesach, it's also, you need to bring poor people to eat. Mitzvah, to bring them. What do we say? Kol dichfin, yetev v'yichol, every ditzrich, kol ditzrich, yetev v'yifsach. Everyone who needs a place to eat, we are welcoming everyone who needs a place. That's Pesach. Sukkot. Rabbi, my room in the sukkah is too tight. It's not Monsi here, it's Queens. You know, everything is closed, small. Over there, but you have land, you can build a sukkah for 200 people. But here, everything is, well, we eliminate the driveway to make sukkah. There's hardly any property, so what are we going to do? If you have room in your heart, you'll find room in a sukkah. That's usually the rule. But, Rabotai, It's written in a midrash, Bereshit Rabbah, that thanks to mitzvat achnasat orchim that Avraham Avinu did, we got the mitzvah of Sukkah. There's a direct connection. Avraham said to his guests, Ishanuna tachat ha'etz, rest under the tree, the shade of the tree. Hashem said, you took care of these strangers and you gave them a place to hide from the sun. Your children will have the same thing. They will sit in a Sukkot in the Exodus of Egypt, and this protection will protect them from the heat, from the very strong sun in the desert. That's why Sukkot symbolized the matter of Achnasat Orchim. Why? Because we got that holiday thanks to that mitzvah. What else? Chafetz Chaim used to say, 100 years ago he lived, Yeda machnis oreach, shekol adam ve'adam hu rak oreach ba'olam hazeh. Chafetz Chaim say, every time you have a guest, when a guest comes to stay in your house, he sleeps a day, 2 days, a week, everybody knows it's temporary. Whether you like him, it's going to be over. If you don't like him, it's also going to be over. Everything will be over. Soon he's out of here. Oh, I wish he would stay longer, but he has to go back. It's a guest only. That's to remind each one of us that we are only guests in this world. Just a guest. I'm giving you a house, a car, some things to use while you are a guest in my world. You are a guest here. How many years? You don't even know. 70, 80, 20, 50, you don't know. I want to tell you a sad story. We had a very big party in my house on Monday night. Every Sukkot we do by me, get the whole yeshiva, all the friends from Monsi, and we make, Baruch Hashem, the happiest party you ever saw in your life. And there was, when the guy started to show up, a father and a son came with a secular guy. They walked with him into the sukkah. Never saw him before. Looked a little familiar, but he came and sat right next to me. I started to talk to him, to this guy. Do I know you from anything? You look familiar? No, you never saw me. You never came to the yeshiva before? I came briefly. Where are you from? Who is this guy? A family of the wife of the father. So he happened to be by them. They brought him into the party. As everyone is happy and singing, the son came to me and say, what do you think we can do for this guy? Now I'm already thinking, I don't need him to tell me. When I see a secular person next to me, immediately I'm beginning to think about the strategy. How do I get this guy to wake up that he should start keeping mitzvot? So I'm thinking, should I give him USB? Should I give him a book? As I'm thinking, the guy came to me and say, it's such a sad story. Say, why? Say, a few weeks to live. Young, 25 maybe. I have cancer in his head. The doctors gave up on him. They don't even give him chemo. So now I'm thinking, it's such a happy moment, and everyone is happy and eating and drinking, dancing, the sukkah is shaking. No one, that's the floor actually broke. The guy came to fix it today. Imagine 30, 40 people jump on the deck of the sukkah. It's a miracle she didn't crash. But now my heart was thinking about this poor guy. So I said, okay, we give him a book. So when I gave him the book, I said, listen to me. This life in this world, we are only guests here. One is a guest for longer, and one is a guest for a shorter period of time. But in the end, life is a blink of the eye. There's not that much of a difference, 25, 55, 95. It's a blink of the eye. The question is, where are we going from here? So I said to him, I'm giving you now a ticket to life of eternity in the highest level. If you read the book, and you follow the instructions over there, you'll be very happy to leave this world. You won't miss it. Just take my advice. Trust me, you won't regret it. You promise? Yes. Shook hands. I was able to continue to be happy. Because I know he's going to read the book. That's it. He's going to do tshuva. Do tshuva, even a week before Chas V'Shalom he die. At least he has a chelek l'olam haba. To be mechalel Shabbat, get cancer in the head, die, and don't have a share to the world to come. One could be worse than that. No this world and no next world. So Rabotai, we just learned one more thing here. What is it? That Sukkah is a place to have guests. But Rabotai, I want to tell you a few more things. In Pesach, in Sukkot, they used to sacrifice cows. How many? 70. 70 cows. If they have a Siddur here of Sukkot, they have a Siddur of Sukkot here? 70 cows, thank you very much. 70 cows. How many of the cows are for the Goyim? How many of the cows are for the next nation of Israel? Who knows? Huh? From 70 cows.
69.
From 70 cows. Chag Sameach, מה שלום כבודו? טוב, from 70 cows, 69 are for the Goyim, one cow is for the nation of Israel. Why? Because there are 70 nations. Today we have hundreds of nations. But some nations are all one, like the Arabs. They have 20 countries. It's all Ishmael. 20 countries, it's one minister. The minister of Ishmael. Then in the Africans, they divided to many, many countries. They're all one minister. Cyprus, Greece, all these areas, one minister. So if you look at the entire world, it's 70 angels in heaven. Each one represents one race or one nation. And we have one angel of the nation of Israel. What's his name?
God.
Huh?
God.
No, Shem is the creator of the world. He's not an angel. Michael Sar Israel. Now, Rabotai, the Gemara says when the Goyim destroyed Bet HaMikdash, they made damage not just to Israel, to themselves. Because every year we pray there on Sukkot for the Goyim, that they have peace, that they have success, and now they came to Bet HaMikdash and destroyed the place that is actually helping them. Now, Rabotai, I wanna ask you a question. If you have Korban Pesach, you're allowed to let the Goy eat from the sacrifice?
No.
Anyone who's not circumcised, Arel, cannot eat in Korban Pesach. Are you allowed to bring Goyim into the Sukkah?
No.
Also not. Why? It's a holiday that Hashem gave to those who came out of Egypt. However, after there will be Gog u'Magog, and Hashem will wipe out all the wicked people from the world, Jews and non-Jews, all the atheists, all the anti-religion, all the idol worshippers, all the horrible people on earth, whether they are Jewish, whether they are Goyim, cannot survive after the Messiah would come, after will be Gog u'Magog, will be only righteous Jews and righteous Gentiles. What will happen to the righteous Gentile? They will come, all of them, to Jerusalem to celebrate the holiday of Sukkot. Very strange. That's the words of the Navi. Why will Hashem bring the Goyim to celebrate the holiday of Sukkot. And the Navi said that there will be goyim that refuse to come. And Hashem will bring them what? A pandemic. Just like COVID. But those who would come, they will come to celebrate in Jerusalem. The Gemara brings an interesting story. The Gemara said, in the future to come, the Goyim will have a major complaint against Hashem. They will say to Hashem, it's not fair. If you give us Torah and mitzvot, we would also be like the Jews. You gave us barely anything, and the Jews got so many mitzvot, and Hashem say, okay, I'm going to give you a mitzvah. Which mitzvah? Sukkot. I want you to build Sukkot, those are the rules, make the schach, get it natural, cut from the trees, do, has to be at least 3 walls, tough. The Goyim say, okay, fine. Why Hashem gave them mitzvah Sukkah?
Easy.
Because it's a cheap mitzvah. Well, today it's not anymore the case. It's some Sukkot $5,000. But in the old days, everybody knew how to work with wood and trees. You chop some trees, you cut them with saw, you make some wood. You don't have Home Depot, it all comes ready from China. So you have to do it homemade. Then you put some tar, you close the gaps, the holes, you make a schach, half a day you have a sukkah. How much it costs you? Nothing. It's all from nature, from the forest. Today we are very, very spoiled. Who wants to go and chop trees to build sukkah? Tough. So we buy it already. Today it's plastics and metal, all kinds of different easy sukkot. You even have a sukkah with air. You put air into it, like a balloon, and you have a sukkah. You put a mat on top, beautiful, with a pump. You connect it, sukkah. 20 people can eat inside. What happens if you have you are with your car and you're on the road? You're on the road. You need sukkah to eat bread and mezonot. The Ashkenazim, they even make bracha on mezonot, lishev basukkah. Sfaradim don't make bracha on mezonot, lishev basukkah, borei mine mezonot, and they eat in a sukkah. Other things, that it's not mezonot and amotzi, if you don't have sukkah, you can eat out of the sukkah. It's not recommended, but meatball, for instance, with rice, you can eat out of the sukkah. Some people in Israel, they live in a building, they don't have sukkah. All week, they don't eat bread. In the holiday, they go to the sukkah of the shul. 5-10 minutes, they eat 2 ounces of bread, make birkat hamazon, go back to the house and continue the meal. Because the first night of Sukkot, you have to eat bread, just like you must eat matzah in the night of Leila Seder. The rest of the week, you have no obligation to eat bread in a sukkah. Meaning, you don't have to eat bread. Besides the holiday and Shabbat, about the weekdays, like today. Who told you to eat bread? Don't have to eat bread. Don't eat mezonot. What do you eat? Eat rice, eat vegetables, eat fruits. For that, you can manage without sukkah. We eat everything in sukkah. Besides drinking water. But other than that, we try to eat fruits, everything in a sukkah. But I'm just saying, some people live in buildings. They don't have sukkah. They don't have a terrace. Even if you have a terrace, if you have another terrace on top of you, it makes the sukkah not kosher. Sukkah must be under the sky. It cannot be under trees. It cannot be under another terrace or ceiling. It has to be under the sky. You have to see the sky from the schach, in between the lines. So, Rabotai, Hashem gave the goyim, will give the goyim mitzvah sukkah. The Midrash say, Hashem take out the sun, it will be a boiling hot day, very hot, like Avraham Avinu in the third day of his Brit Milah. Hashem took out the sun kechom hayom, double than Arizona. Imagine Arizona, you have a car, you put your car 20 minutes in the sun, you can make an omelet on the wood. You open the egg, sunny side up.
It's dry feet, Rabbi.
Huh?
Dry feet is different.
You got the point. Very, very hot. So now the goyim, they build a sukkah. They sit 5 minutes in a sukkah. They go crazy. They get up, kick the sukkah, like they say in America, the heck with this sukkah. And they go back into the room with the air condition. Ah, thank God for saving us from God. That's basically what they will say. So Hashem will say to them, shame on you. I gave you one mitzvah, doesn't cost anything to do. After 10 minutes, you kicked it and you don't want it. You want to keep the whole 613 commandments? This is the Midrash. Who can tell me what's wrong with that story?
They took away free will.
Huh?
They took the free will away.
No!
Yeah, they had the free will.
Why? Why took the free will? We don't. Today was 84 degrees. We sat in a sukkah and ate.
It's more than that.
Whatever. What is there?
They weren't happy.
They didn't have a
They were exempt to leave.
Oh!
They
when we are suffering in a sukkah, we have an obligation to be in a sukkah, it will be 110 degrees and humid, and you sweat like crazy. That's not a pleasure of a holiday. So what happened? You don't need to eat in a sukkah. If it's freezing or raining, you don't eat in a sukkah. So what is the complaint of Hashem against the goyim? The goyim, They are suffering inside the sukkah. If I'm suffering inside the sukkah, I also go in. The answer is that they kick the sukkah. What does it mean to kick the sukkah? Not literally to kick. Meaning, Baruch Sheptarano, I'm so happy to get rid of this lousy sukkah. That's what they would say. We, if it's raining on us at night, we eat a heart that we have to move in. We would want to be outside. If it's too cold, we walk into the house with a broken heart. If it's too hot, we walk into the house with a broken heart. They don't go into the house with a broken heart. They kick the sukkah, meaning, Allah, who needs it? So what do you learn from here? The way you treat the mitzvah sometimes is more important than the actual mitzvah. For instance, when you buy your Mercedes, you invest every additional extra thing in the car. Sunroof and special speakers and special leather and special this and special features. When you need to buy tefillin for your son bar mitzvah, Rabbi, don't you have the cheaper one? It's too much, $1,500. Maze. Don't you have for $600, $700? Meat for Yom Tov costs more than that. It's more than a year to make tefillin, more than a year of work to make it. From the minute it was a cow until it became tefillin, more than a year of work. More than 1,000 steps. If one of them you messed up, it's not kosher. It's much harder than to make diamonds. But for a diamond, it will pay $50,000. For the Mercedes, 150 or 300. But for the tefillin, don't you have cheaper mezuzot? Why $100 mezuzah? It's so much. Because it takes 4 hours to make. And the klaf alone is like $15. And the metayek, few dollars. And the computer check, few dollars. And another sofer that check, few dollars. So after all the expenses, how much you have left the sofer? 60, 70 bucks? And from that, he has to pay 45% taxes in Israel.
He gets cash.
Mas Hachnasa.
Gets
cash, but the cash you have to put somewhere. What do you think? You can fool the Israeli Mas Hachnasa? Believe me, you know how the Israeli catch the businesses that cheat them on their Mas Hachnasa? They check their orders. Pizza shop, how many bags of flour they order this year? They calculate how many pans of pizza is this, and based on that, it's how come you only put 30% of the amount of pies you made this year, and you go to jail. They kill you, take away everything you have. They're very, very evil. They're very evil. You don't want to fall in their hands. It's like falling in a KGB hands in Russia. Same thing. Yes. And they have fake customers who come. Now in Israel, it's different than here. Here, if you sell something and you don't type it in a cash register, it's not the end of the world. But in Israel, if a customer comes, he gives you cash and you do not type it into the cash register, you get arrested immediately. They close your business, they arrest you, you go to jail for investigation, lawyers and this, they close your business. Why? Oh, you're not reporting. Why? Because they know, they see, that you have to keep the rules. How many transactions you did? Some crooks in Israel, they have two cash registers. Mm-hmm. One they report and the other one they don't. But they thought about everything. There's no way against them. And you know what they do? They suspect you, they make up a number. You owe us $200,000. Ah, the whole year I didn't make $200,000. That's what you owe. Pay it or we will destroy you. There's nothing you can do. The court is on their side. It's terrible. When you have no Yirat Shamayim, no Torah, they are worse than the mafia. The mafia, everybody knows to stay away from them. They, you think they want, they care about the citizen. It's just another criminal organization protected by the law. That's what they are. In Israel, it's worse if you do not pay. Let's say if you bounce a check, and the person process it, they come to your house and break your face for the check. You have to pay $2,000. I don't have right now. They take off the TV, they take the leather couch, they take your laundry machine. They take it out of the house. It's different, different than here. Here, nobody can talk to you. Hey, your check that you gave me bounced. Call me next year. Welcome to America. In Israel, it's not like that. Do you know how people are afraid to bounce a check? Yeah. I had one person, he gave me a few checks, one for every month in Israel. He said, don't deposit the check. I will give you cash when the time comes. I don't want you to deposit the check. Once I give you the check, rip the check. Once I give you the cash, rip the check and send me a picture that you ripped the check. Do you know how many times he called? Until he will see that the check was ripped. Because their biggest nightmare is that you deposit a check and you won't have coverage. Then it's hotzah lapoal. Do you understand why? Gestapo. I just want to finish with one thing, Rabotai, and we're done. But for that, I kept the best to the end. You know, on Sukkot we read, in Shabbat Chol HaMoed, this year we didn't have Shabbat Chol HaMoed because both holidays fell on Shabbat. But usually we have in the middle of Sukkot, Shabbat. On that Shabbat, we read Milchemet Gog u'Magog, the final war that will end the world. It's called Gog u'Magog. Why we read it on Shabbat of Sukkot? Because we know by tradition that the final war will start in the middle of Sukkot. That's why we read Zachary 14, how the world will come to an end. This year, we don't have Shabbat Chol HaMoed. We don't read it. But on Yom Tov of Sukkot, what do we read? What Haftarah we read? Who remembers? King Solomon is building Bet HaMikdash. Who was supposed to build it? His father David, David HaMelech. But Hashem said, David cannot build it. David cannot build. Why he cannot build? Because he killed people, he killed soldiers in the middle of the war. So, he killed people in the war, hence that spilled blood cannot build an altar that help people to return, to repent, to make an atonement. We don't have a regular Israeli Siddur. Regular. Here, give me one of these. It's with all the English here. That's good. Thank you. That's it. Pass it. One second. Here. So, thank you. What do we read? The first chag we read about. Let me read it to you. I don't read the whole thing. I just read few verses for you, that you will see, you know, what we talked about. So the first, the Shlomo HaMelech is building Bet HaMikdash, right? He's building Bet HaMikdash, and it's written that David couldn't build it, so King Solomon has to build it. And right after that, we're going to read now, Be'ezrat Hashem, on Shmini Atzeret, meaning on Shabbat morning, which is the first Yom Tov, we're going to read about the sacrifices of King Solomon in Bet HaMikdash. Before I get to it, on Sukkot we read, Vayikalu el HaMelech Shlomo. Everyone gathered to the King Solomon. The Kohanim brought the covenant, and they came into Ol Moed, and everybody is preparing the cattle, the sheep, the cows, that you cannot count. There's so many, you can't even count how many. And what's inside the coffin? The Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments. So how many years is after we received the Ten Commandments? 300 years. 300 years after Moses brought the Ten Commandments. So inside you have the complete Ten Commandments, the second ones, and the broken ones. So the king gives a blessing to the nation of Israel. I chose a place to put my name into it. I chose David to be the king of my nation, to build a house for me in Jerusalem, but he could not build it. You will not build it, but your son, Shlomo, will build it. Tov, that's what we read on Sukkot. But that's not what I wanted to talk about. Now we're going to read on Shabbat morning. Please pay attention when we read the Haftarah. What do we read on Shabbat morning? We read Rega. Oh. Rega. Oh, here it is. Vayi kechalot Shlomo litpalel, when King Solomon finished to pray, in front of the altar of Hashem, bending down on his knees, his hands are all the way up to the sky, bless the nation of Israel, right? And what happened right after that? He began the sacrifices. How many sacrifices they brought in one day? Who knows? Listen carefully, you won't believe it. 22,000 cows. How much a cow costs today? Minimum $5,000. Minimum. How much is 22,000 cows? $110 million. That's the cost of it, according to today's prices. And 120,000 sheep, which is $500 each in College Point here. Small one, not so fat. The fat one are more. So 120,000 multiplied by 500 is $60 million. 210 million. plus 60 is $170 million in one day. That's the cost of the animals in one day they sacrifice in the grand opening of the Bet HaMikdash. Why am I telling you all of that? And we finish with a beautiful story. King David asked Hashem, When will I die? Hashem told him, I do not tell a human being the day of his death. Why? It will eliminate his free will. If he's 40 and he knows he has until 80, no rush. I'll do tshuva when I'm 79. What's the rush? I do whatever I want. The last year of my life, I give all my money to charity. I do kiruv, I support Torah. I become a full tzaddik, sit all day in yeshiva, fix everything I should fix, and I die, mamash tzaddik esod olam. But that's not fair, ma. You're playing games. No one knows until when he dies. Today, tomorrow, next year. There's no knowledge. So King David say, okay, if you don't want to tell me when I'll die, at least tell me what day of the week it will be. So Hashem told him, it will be on Shabbat. He got very upset. From all the days of the week, I will die on Shabbat? What's the problem? You cannot do a funeral on Shabbat. You can't move the body. It's Muktzeh. To wait until either Saturday night or Sunday morning. So he said to Hashem, why on Shabbat? You can't give me one more day of life. What is it for you? Take me on Sunday. He said, that Sunday, the kingdom of your son Shlomo has begun. It cannot be two kings in the same place. You must clear your place, leave the world, and your son become a king. As long as you are alive, he cannot be a king. His father's rice for him, for his son, cannot be. Okay, so don't worry about my son's kingdom. Take me one day earlier, on Friday. I give up a day of my life. Hashem said to him, shame on you. It's so easy for you to give up a day of life. You should know that one day that you sit and learn Torah is better for me than all these thousand sacrifices that your son Shlomo will sacrifice to me in the temple. The power of Torah is above anything you can imagine. Sacrifices, no matter what. There's nothing greater than Torah. You want to give up a day of your Torah? So easy? Meaning I'm so anxious for your Torah, I enjoy it so much. Especially David HaMelech with his holiness. So what did David do? Say, okay, you know what? Shabbat, I don't move from the Gemara. Sit and learn all day. Learn Torah all day. Why? When you learn Torah, the Satan is afraid to come near you. With the tricks of David HaMelech, he didn't think that the Satan is a little bit more clever than him. After all, he saw all the tricks already. He's very experienced. So Satan made the noise outside the garden. Ay! Like someone just fell from the stairs. What's the instinct of a kosher person when someone is falling? Jumped immediately to see. When he came to see, the Satan pulled out his soul, and that was the end of it. That Shabbat was what day? Shavuot. Shavuot. So it means that David HaMelech learned all night, and not like us, run to bed, eat some cheesecake quickly and burekas, and dive into the bed for the rest of the day. No. You know what I'm talking about, huh? He had no choice. He had to stay until the night. Once Shabbat is finished, that's when he can go to sleep. But the Satan saw, he tricked him. And that's how, that was the end of David and the beginning of Shlomo. How old was Shlomo when he became the king? 13. The dream he had, that Hashem asked him, what do you want? And he didn't say to kill my enemies or money or power, none of that. You know what he asked? Give me a smart, fair heart, meaning mind, to judge your nation in an honest way. Meaning I want to be a servant to you. What is the king has to do? To be fair with the nation. And Hashem told him, since you didn't ask for anything for yourself, you ask for me, not for yourself, I'll give you everything. And that's why he became the smartest person ever lived. The smartest person ever lived. Meaning, if King Solomon would say, give me strength to kill all my enemies, he would get that. He wouldn't be anything special. Give me a lot of money and power, he would get that, but he would not be the smartest person ever lived. When he thought about Hashem before he thought about himself, he got all the blessing you can imagine. Do you know when you want to say about the rabbi that is a huge giant chacham, what do you call him in Hebrew? Amud Yemani. Did you hear that or no? A patish chazak. You heard that? There's all kinds of expression. Patish chazak meaning strong hammer, meaning it explodes everything. Ma ze amud yemani?
Huh? The side of the Yemenite?
Amud means a pole. Yemani means righty. Amud a Yemani. You see two poles here? That's the lefty, that's the righty. Why would you call a Talmid Chacham Amud a Yemani? The right pole.
What's right? That's left.
Huh?
Left is the Din.
Anyone who knows the answer, get right now $100. No? Without Google. No, Rabbi Google, even though I don't think they have the answer there. No? First chance.
$100?
Yeah, on the spot.
What is the question, Rabbi?
Why you call a Talmid Chacham Amud Yemani?
Because he looks on the right. Tzaddik always looks on the right, so he looks on how many pages of Gemara he's already done. He doesn't worry about how much there is left.
Not to be a lefty, that means you can be a righteous, but it doesn't mean you are a Talmid Chacham. We're talking about someone that is he knows the entire Torah. The answer is, Rabotai, when you roll the Torah all the way to the end, just like now. וזאת הברכה אשר, נכון? We are in the last parasha now. We read it in Simchat Torah. All the Torah is on the right pole. When you say Amud Yemani, means the entire Torah is in his head. If you want to say about someone that is Am Haaretz, and you don't want him to know that that's what you mean, call him Amud Asmali. Everything is on the left pole.
At a certain point.
Nothing is on the right. Meaning he didn't even start the Torah. But if you say Amud Yemani, nobody knows it, by the way. Test anyone you want, rabbis, bachurei yeshiva, my bet, not one person will know. I didn't know it until a few days ago. I just found out. You think I'm so generous just to start giving out hundreds of dollars in my lecture for knowing the right answer? But Baruch Hashem, we covered everything. Any questions before we finish? Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen v'amen.